I'm Dan Andrews, the Premier of Victoria. In my job, I get to meet some pretty inspiring people. One of those is 16-year-old Georgie Stone. Georgie's fought hard to be true to herself and battled prejudice and legal challenges to get there. And now she's trying to make it easier for other young people who face the same hurdles. This is her story.
Do you think needs a harmony?
Yeah.
So if I'm doing...
One of these mornings...
Yeah.
You're gonna rise up, sing.
Yeah, you can go down, I think.
I love my daughter to the moon and back.
Try it again. One of these mornings... You're gonna rise up, singing.
Nice.
Music is a big communication between the two of us.
Summertime, and the living is easy.
She has made me a better person. It's been an amazing journey. And I mean, I can't speak for anyone else in the family, but I'm grateful for it all.
Yeah, your daddy is rich.
I was very fearful back then, but I'm not anymore.
And your mom is good looking now, now.
His struggle is completely understandable. It's hard, and I know it was hard for me, but I think he was probably the last out of my immediate family to understand, but once he did, he was completely on board.
With Daddy and Mummy standing by.
Georgie has defied gravity from the moment she was born, because no matter how much people have tried to drag her down, she has risen above it every time. And not only that, she's brought everybody with her.
I did, at an early age, think of myself as a boy because everyone else was calling me a boy, but there was always something inside that wasn't right. It just felt wrong, and I get really emotional. It was like, it just sort of tears would well up when I'd say, I'm a boy.
Then you spread your wings and you take to the sky. But until that moment.
So Georgie's parents, Beck and Greg, met on the stage many years ago now and fell in love.
We just had a lovely time together, and then we decided to get married about 1999.
Day, he met Miss
Mousy
on the way out.
A year later, she was pregnant with twins, and that was a massive thing. It was like, oh my God, twins, you don't expect that. And we had two boys, two lovely boys, Harry and George. Or so we thought. Harry would always, dress in Blunstons and boy stuff, Buzz Lightyear and all of that stuff. But Georgie's heroes were always Cinderella, Snow White, Dorothy. When she'd go to the dress-up box, she would always go for dresses, fabrics, colours, that sort of thing.
Georgie and I's relationship in our youngest of years as little kids, we really got each other. She was very open with me in her femininity.
Can I hold Mum's hand?
Would often try and encourage George to play with boy things, like be interested in football and, all those, typical male things. But Georgie just, she didn't go for it.
Here's young George and young Harrison, your first day of school. Hi.
Once he saw how adamant I was that I wanted to be female, I think he finally realised that I, not that I was telling the truth, he knew that I was sincere, but that I was serious about it.
So Greg, I think, struggled quite a bit in the early stages of this journey. Very little was known. A lot has changed in the last 10 years. I think for Greg, he felt he'd had two boys and that was the natural order of things. So was Beck doing things to change that? Did she secretly want a girl? And I think he blamed her at times or questioned.
It must have been incredibly tough for Beck, or I suggested that she had encouraged this, which was a terrible, terrible thing to say because, you know, it's not true. It doesn't work like that. But I think I was struggling with it. So I was looking at all, I know this sounds like I'm trying to justify what I did, which was terribly wrong. But I was looking for answers.
I was feeling very isolated, I think, as a result of that. And I was as scared as he was, but I was supposed to be responsible for not only causing it, but also making it better, finding the help, supporting Georgie.
I didn't really know what to do, and I thought, oh my God, if George at that time is transgender, what is his life going to be like? There wasn't a lot on the internet. You know, you'd type in transgender and you'd end up on some porn site.
Greg's love for Georgie was so great that he was willing to take a leap of faith almost before he may even have been ready to accept Georgie as his daughter, but he was ready to make a big, wonderful, generous gesture.
I took Georgie down to the shops and I bought her a dress. We bought a dress together.
Georgie was really badly bullied at the first primary school. She was called names, she was stared at, pointed at, and it was a fairly constant daily occurrence.
They saw that I was becoming more feminine, hung out with girls, started growing my hair, and they would come up to me and say things like, are you a boy or a girl? Or, you can't be a girl, you're actually a boy. This isn't right. You're weird, you're a freak. I thought that this is what my life was going to be like, my whole life. It just seemed like such an uphill battle. I didn't know where things were going to go. And I'd come home saying really depressing things like, I want to die. It'd be easy if I was dead. And things like, I'm a girl disguised as a boy. Why can't they see that I'm a girl? And I think I started scaring my parents a little bit.
Very carefully, cut into the cake and make a wish. The fact that she was starting to say things about hurting herself, I was terrified and stressed.
I just thought that I couldn't live like this. That's when I started going to psychiatrist, Dr. Campbell Paul.
It's very common for kids who are really struggling with the issue of their gender to feel depressed and hopeless and to contemplate even suicide.
Where do we actually have the session?
So the session's just around at the end of the corridor there.
Okay,
so yeah. Let's go around.
Okay, yeah.
Where to go.
Cool.
I think she thought that going to him would solve her problem right then and there and that there would be some kind of magic pill that she could take and she'd come back home as a girl.
Georgie was seven when I first saw her. She was very clear that she didn't want to hurt anyone and cause any problem or any trouble.
Show me what you're wearing for your Easter egg hunt.
I'm wearing Crocs and a blue skirt and white top with a trunnet.
Very nice.
Some kids might say, I feel like a girl, or I feel like a boy, or I prefer to do girls' things or boys' things. But Georgie and many of the young people we see are much more clear about that. I am a boy or I am a girl, despite the way my body appears.
Oh, well, we'd better find out about how school's going and...
Yeah, just been loving it.
Georgie was already experiencing a lot of distress around her gender identity. If we hadn't have found Campbell Paul, I think that distress would have increased dramatically. He has been so wonderful for Georgie and he's saved her life. Absolutely.
Yeah, after Dr. Paul I felt much happier and much more safe.
You didn't feel safe before that?
Well, no, because not that many people understood about me.
I felt like a mythical creature. I wasn't really real. And I felt real when I was with Doc Paul.
But we've been saving money because we're going to America at the end of the year.
Oh, that's good.
I knew that I would be okay and that what the bullies were saying, it was wrong. I wasn't weird. I wasn't a freak. It happens, and it gave me a greater sense of self-belief. I am a girl, and that helped me through the events that were to come.
Well, hi, my name's Georgie Stone, and we just finished the Christmas tree here.
Once Georgie was diagnosed, I was relieved. In a way, I think we were all relieved because finally we knew this was it. So we just embraced it.
And look up there. There's your camera.
Oh, hi.
So if ever you're talking, don't look at that.
All you want as a parent is to have a happy child and for that child to be themselves.
The weirdest faces you can. 1, 2, 3. Okay.
Remind me of Ollie. I loved Once. I think that's my favourite thing that I've seen you do.
To know that Georgie wanted to kill herself if she couldn't become who she is, you just do anything to help them. You just do. See, some people say, oh, you know, you guys have been so heroic or whatever. But it's not heroic at all. It's just you're just doing your job as a parent.
Maybe don't come because it's awful.
I thought that I was leaving the brother behind until I learned that I didn't lose my brother. I always had a sister.
How do you feel about your brother becoming a girl?
Well, at first I felt confused. So I didn't say love for nothing because I was confused.
Transition for Georgie actually was a very gradual thing. So it wasn't like one day we were dressing her like a boy and the next we were dressing her like a girl. It was a process over a long period of time. And that process needed to take place slowly so that everyone around her could catch up.
At the age of 10, the endocrinologist discovered that Georgie's testosterone had gone through the roof. She was entering puberty. And so it was urgent that we got on to puberty blockers.
So what do you think is going to happen after you have the puberty blockers?
Well, then I won't go on to a boy. I won't get clothes older and apples. I really don't want to get a head chest.
Georgie, like all children at that time, were required to go to the Family Court of Australia to get permission to start on puberty blockers. Puberty blockers are medications that essentially stop the production of estrogen or testosterone, depending on what biological sex you are. So for Georgie, going on blockers meant that her face didn't masculinize, her voice didn't deepen, and that she wasn't at risk of growing facial or body hair consistent with a masculine appearance. For Georgie, there was a race against time. It really was an emergency.
I was at the point where I was thinking I might go overseas and try and access some drugs illegally, bring them back. Because if Georgie went through puberty, it would have been terrible. We would have failed. It would have been something that we would have regretted for the rest of our life.
I rang around various places and eventually found a group of lawyers who agreed to do it for us, which was a huge relief, because had we not found them, I don't know what we would have done.
When I was 11 and when I was granted puberty blockers by the Family Court of Australia, it was a massive victory, not only for me but for Australia, because I was the youngest person to be granted permission to have puberty blockers.
Look at all of these court documents. Oh God. We decided to appeal the Family Court's jurisdiction over the authorisation of treatment for young transgender Australians. Dear Minister Davis, Australia is the only jurisdiction in the world where young transgender children have to go to court to seek the treatment that they are entitled to, that is appropriate for them. Risks of treatment.
Oh, yes.
The family court judges always take the advice of the doctors anyway, so it's an incredibly expensive, time-consuming and worrying, deeply distressing experience for families who feel that they're being judged for who they are.
It's scary. Thinking that we have to do this all again.
Yeah, I know. In 2013, even though we'd had a victory in the family court, it was only a partial victory. All transgender young people can access pubertal suppression without the intervention of the Family Court of Australia. Transgender children still had to go to court to access treatment for stage two, which is the cross-sex hormones. So we had another battle ahead of us. Georgie and Harry shared a womb, and they have had that closeness all their lives.
Georgie has her moments where she loses rationality, she loses sanity.
Usually and, when I'm tired.
Yeah.
I think I'm the naughty one. I'm the naughty twin. But look at him, he's just an angel.
Joy.
I think during those years where we were very focused on Georgie, Harry got a little left behind. We kept thinking, oh yeah, Harry's great, Harry's fine. You know, isn't he coping well?
Oh, she got the back of my hand. For years, I was left to fend for myself as they were fighting in court for Georgie. And that was around the time that there was bullying, but also mental illness. I fell into a deep depression for quite a few years and didn't speak up, nor did anyone notice.
It breaks my heart that he felt neglected. I can just imagine now him just feeling that no one wanted him, no one wanted to talk to him, and it just, I get a little bit emotional thinking about it. I just feel so sorry that that happened, that he felt so alone, and I'm glad that he finally told us.
History repeated itself last year because we had to go back to court again. We thought we'd gone through it all 2 years before for stage one treatment.
And
We might even do a blood test today, if that's okay, because it's been a couple of months since we last did it. Cool.
At the beginning of 2015, around about May, we went for an usual checkup and a blood test, and we found that her testosterone level had spiked incredibly since the last visit.
All right, and just standing. So Georgie, like all adolescents, had to go back to the family court to get gender-affirming hormones. So for Georgie, that was oestrogen. Georgie was never cross-examined in court. They never assessed Georgie themselves. They rely on us. And we are the right people to determine if she is competent to make those decisions.
The clock was ticking very quickly for Georgie. Biology is fast. The court process is very slow.
And now we thought, what, we've got this far, and what, her voice is going to break? She's going to get an Adam's apple? We were angry. I think we were really angry and incredibly distressed.
I was looking in the mirror, looking at every detail. If my voice started to break, that would completely change my life. I wouldn't be the female that I always wanted to be. I wouldn't be taken at face value anymore. I would have wanted to kill myself.
So this is what all the fuss was about, an $11.95 packet of estrogen tablets. We had to go to court to get these tablets. It took a lot of time and effort, but it's been worth it for me because now I can be who I am. I'm seeing so many positive changes in my body, being able to go through female puberty. I'm growing breasts. I'm getting curves, and it's just psychologically, I've been so much happier than last year.
I want to know what sort of mascara I have. I have like this one, and I don't know if it's good.
Because she's actually getting on with her life, because she has had the right support at the right time, in the right way, she's been able to grow and develop alongside her peers. And flourish.
No, you just told me that you'd broken up with him, like, and it was like, oh, how long?
I met my best friends Leah and Alex when I was six.
I never really wanted to, like, darken it or just make it about me and what I was going through. I wanted our friendship to be just fun-based only. When we were 11, Leah completely forgot.
Yeah, and it was just... I completely forgot. That's how
and that was like the best compliment ever. Yeah. Going like, oh, and all the bullying, you know, me being transgender, and Leah's like, you're transgender!
I had not. Yeah, I completely forgot.
That's how tiny it is. That's how much it really doesn't matter in our friendship, because I love Georgie for her and not because, well, like, her being transgender is just... It's just something you know, don't really, you know, factor in friendship. Friendship is just because you love each other.
Not much, to be honest. It's like a family day.
Georgie is currently in year 10, and she decided to come out towards the end of last year.
Did you guys do the test?
Yes, the most strawberry in your
what test? The quiz that I did last night.
2 years ago, my family and I were very private about me being transgender.
Oh, can I have some popcorn?
Yeah, sure.
I think we were just scared of bullies. The students have been fantastic. I think it is a really good opportunity for me to educate my peers. I have had a few weird questions like, what sort of underwear do I wear? Do I pee standing up? And also, I think probably the best one out of the weird question was, does my brother have a vagina? and, like, it's fine, you can ask those questions. It's funny and it's good that it's the reason that I should be doing this.
Hey, how are we all?
When we heard that the Victorian Premier was coming to visit the school and to meet with Georgie, there was certainly great excitement.
Daniel Andrews came to meet me, the principal, my mum, my brother, a few of my friends as well, to talk about the importance of the Safe Schools Coalition.
and so we can tell a story of how cats are more aggressive.
The Safe Schools Coalition goes to schools and helps both the students and the teachers understand the importance of a safe environment for LGBTIQ kids. I told Daniel Andrews about my experiences of being bullied. He asked my friends about what it was like when I came out to them.
Imagine you've had a really bad day at work, you come home and you want some love and attention, but here is your cat scratching you.
It's enormously important to myself and my community that Elwood College is a safe place for all students, but in this particular case, using Georgie as an example, I think it's a great reminder of the responsibility that we have to actually unleash an amazing young woman onto the world.
Will we go to Canberra again?
Well, I think we will.
So Georgie's becoming an extraordinary advocate for transgender people. She's developed a voice. For Georgie, it's about making sure that other people don't have to go through maybe some of the despair she's gone through.
I'd really like to meet with Tanya Plibersek as well. Mm. She's.
I want to get this out of the courts. It's ludicrous that we don't just listen to the doctors, the specialists who know best. The family court always takes the advice of the doctors. It is a waste of time, money, and stress.
And maybe Daniel Andrews.
Having changed the law for stage one treatment, it's given us a feeling that we can actually make a difference, because we have. And we have something to fight for.
Perhaps the matter needs to be reconsidered. But it can only be reconsidered in two circumstances. I can't do anything about it unless someone's prepared to challenge the existing case law, or unless the government is prepared to legislate.
Georgie and I are starting to lobby politicians. Our only recourse now is to ask them to draw up legislation that gets tabled in Parliament and for the law to be changed that way.
And hopefully Tim Wilson can introduce us to some more members.
We went to see Tim Wilson. He is our local Liberal member and he is the former Human Rights Commissioner. I am hoping that Tim might get us in to see the Prime Minister.
Georgie, it's not usual that a 16-year-old takes on such a big campaign and personal journey.
I think Georgie is one of the most amazing young people I've ever met. It is hard not to notice her and to listen and believe that Georgie is going to change things for the better. I have no doubt about it.
I feel like I can actually help people. I'm hoping that after seeing my story, they can see a happy, free 16-year-old girl who has come out the other side.
How you did me wrong, and I grew strong, and I learned.